As you may have heard, our sermon series this fall is called Bless This Mess. Together, we're exploring the ways that we encounter and navigate chaos in our world. And it felt a little wild to me to not talk about families as a source of chaos. The Bible, after all, has no shortage of stories about messy families. I'm sure this room doesn't either. And today's story is a prime example. Although the whole thing is typically called the story of the prodigal son, I think that's really only half of the story. And since we only read the second half today, let me give you a recap of the first part. The Reverend Dr. Greg Mobley has names for two halves of the story that I quite love. So he likes to call the first half, How the Younger Son Loses Everything and Ends Up in a Field. A young man approaches his father and asks him to divide out his inheritance and give it to him early. Now, in our time and place, we know that that is a wildly insulting thing to do. It's as if the younger son said, I wish you were dead. He takes the money and he leaves. The son strikes out on his own but falls upon hard times. And as he stands starving in the middle of a field, hungering after the food that he's throwing to the pigs, he starts to come to his senses. He comes to himself, is what the scripture says. And he prepares an apology and returns home. But before he even gets down the driveway, the father is waiting out the door, runs down the road to greet his son in a warm embrace. Now, running as the patriarch of a good Palestinian family would have been a wild thing to do. Distinguished men do not run, but he does. He runs down the road and embraces his beloved and welcomes him home. Together, they walk back into the house where the father throws a party, complete with a fatted calf. He puts a ring back on the boy's finger, the family ring, and a robe back around his shoulders. But this is only the first half of the story. If the first half can be called how the younger son loses everything and ends up in a field, the second half can be called how the older son earns everything and ends up in a field. We first hear about this elder brother after his sibling has already returned. We find him coming home after a hard day's work to music, to the noise of celebration. His brother is back. And the eldest sibling is furious. He stands in the middle of the field and refuses to go inside. So once again, the father comes out to meet one of his boys. The elder brother makes his case. He says to the father, "Can you believe what this son of yours has done?" He embellishes the story and adds some theories about what his brother may have been doing during his time away. He cannot believe how quickly everyone has forgotten the wrong that was done. He demands justice. To be fair, the older brother doesn't know if his sibling is being sincere. Who's to say that he won't leave again? Maybe this judgment of this older brother is self-protective. Maybe it's protective of the family. But the father reminds his firstborn, this brother of yours was dead and has come to life. He is lost and has been found. The father looks at his eldest son, filthy and standing alone in a field, and he knows how lonely it can be to be right. The elder son is threatened by the grace shown to his sibling because deep down, he's in need of some grace himself. Simone Weil says that the world is made up of gravity and grace. Gravity is all of the laws, the things that you can predict, the places where cause and effect can be easily tracked and controlled. And grace makes up the rest, which I think is most of it. Grace is all of the moments of fortune and forgiveness, the unexpected joys and the gifts that you could never earn. It is the magic of a world that is so unfair in its sheer abundance. The older brother has been trying to get by on gravity alone. Grace is good for people who make mistakes, but it's better to just not mess up in the first place. He has bought into the myth of self-sufficiency, which tells us that the best thing you can do in life is not need anyone. The older brother works hard. He's able to accomplish enough and behave well enough and plan far enough ahead, but the truth is that there has never been a self-made man. And you can't achieve your way out of suffering. And goodness and mercy find you whether you think you deserve them or not. For the type A achievers and planners among us, grace looks an awful lot like chaos. Maybe it is. The older brother left home in a big dramatic moment. The younger brother left home in a big dramatic moment, but the older brother has left home too. In small ways, he has been drifting away. He has become an island. He has done everything right, and yet he's alone. In some ways, I think the older son's journey home is harder than his brother's. I think it's harder to return when we think we're right than when we know that we're wrong. Sometimes the hardest thing about grace is accepting that you actually need it. But you can't be liberated until you can see your captivity. You cannot be liberated until you can see your captivity. There's a party going on right in front of the older brother. All he has to do is join it, and yet he cannot bring himself to go inside. So the father meets his firstborn in the field, and the first thing he says to him is this: "Son, you are always with me, and everything I have is yours." Of all the words that Jesus could choose to put into the mouth of the character representing God in this story, this is the message for us. You are always with me, and everything I have is yours. This is as much a fact as it is a blessing. The elder brother has been grumbling about not getting a fatted calf, but he has forgotten the robe on his back, the ring on his finger, the countless ways that he has walked with his father, talking and laughing and learning together. I think it's easy for us to see God in the big blessings, in the mountaintop experiences, but we don't live our lives on mountaintops. What if, rather than waiting for the next moment of divine encounter, we simply lived as if it's all divine? This world is harsh and ugly and stunning and perfect and divine all at the same time. Our communion elements today were bought at the grocery store. There is nothing special about this bread and juice except that all of it is special. Everything we have is a precious gift from God, and this morning we have gathered to witness it in the bread and the juice. When I was in seminary, I participated in a small group that was intended to build our spiritual lives, to deepen our spiritual lives and our prayer practices. And when the group of 8 aspiring ministers was asked, every single one of us said that we did not think we were spiritual enough. 8 aspiring ministers who had dedicated their lives to the service and pursuit of God, not one of us thought we were doing the God thing right. We thought we didn't pray enough or read the Bible enough, or we just didn't feel however we thought you were supposed to feel if you were spiritual. And like the older brother, I think the problem is that we were looking for God in the gravity and not in the grace. We worship a God who pours lavish love on us and calls to us in every moment. In today's story, the character representing God spends most of his time throwing a party and just trying to get everyone to come. When the father divides his assets to give half to the younger son at the beginning of our story, the word in the scripture for what he is dividing is bios. The father doesn't just divide his stuff, he splits his life. And when the younger son returns and everyone is drawn back together, it's as if the father himself is made whole. I think that God feels that way about each of us.
From the very beginning, the direction of the world has been toward union and relationship. When we gather together, we are stitching up the body of Christ. We are remembering and remembering. The party celebrating the younger brother is not just for him, after all, it's for everyone. Salvation is not a contest, it is a group project. We get free together. In her book, How to Begin When Your World is Ending, which, as a plug, is the foundation of our sermon series this fall, Molly Basket talks about God as lore, as a magnetic pole that draws us to bear witness to the holiness all around us. God calls us to let go of what we think we should do or be or feel and simply join the party. Allow ourselves to be drawn in. I think one of my favorite songs says it best. These are the first few lines of July by Boy. Take off your shoes now. You've come a long way. Walked all these miles and now you're in the right place. This is your party. Everyone came. May it be so. And let the people of God say amen.